Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for waiting. It is now my privilege to introduce our mentor for today, Mr. Gaurav Kapoor. A serial entrepreneur for over 25 years, Gaurav Kapoor currently heads new initiatives and external relations at IIM Calcutta Innovation Park, the business incubator at IIM Calcutta. Having worked across multiple domains, both business and social, Gaurav has a deep focus on social entrepreneurship and brings to the table a wide knowledge base from experiential learning to deep-rooted skills in business planning and development. A social entrepreneur and change maker, Gaurav walks the talk, proactively impacting social and behavioral change in society through a number of not-for-profits he founded and through the extensive motivational work he does as a speaker and evangelist. Gaurav is purpose-led and inspires youth to take on leadership roles and work towards creating meaningful and sustainable impact. Gaurav is a die-hard optimist and an energy magnet. Gaurav, thank you so much for making the time and being here today. We have the students eagerly waiting for you, so we'll not keep them waiting any further. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Shubhayu, and a very good afternoon to all of you. Apologies for being slightly delayed, got stuck up in something very urgent. But I'll make sure that we'll make up for the time that has been lost. Once again, a very good afternoon to all of you. And let me begin by sharing my screen. Is my screen visible?
Yes, Gaurav, we can see your screen.
So let me begin. First of all, it was a let me just begin by saying that it was a lovely moment for me and I think the others who attended the first masterclass yesterday. I think all of us really took back a lot with us, and it was a very meaningful discussion between all of us. I noticed that there were over 250 questions yesterday, and that was extremely enthralling because that just shows the level of interest that we have amongst the student community and the student body today, which really, really, I am really happy about. And I had started off by answering, I tried to address as many questions, but what I can tell you is that don't worry if you had questions yesterday. Most of them will be covered by what we are trying to do today, because this will give you your answers that you had asked questions there yesterday. Okay, so let us begin with the elements of a business plan. So what exactly is a business plan? A business plan is basically a document or a plan that you make before you begin any business. And that would basically include every other aspect of business that you would want to plan ahead in time, so as to ensure that your business is is successful, and the business that you're going to launch or about to launch is going to work. It is not going to fail. You're going to set your business plan to success. And that is the reason why a business plan is so necessary. It includes all those aspects that you need to work upon while you're building your business. And that helps you to reach, at least you know beforehand that if I follow my business plan well, this business will work. So let us see what a business plan would typically include. And the first thing I think, any business plan would include is the value proposition. What is your value proposition? By value proposition, what we mean by saying is that what is your offering to your customer? When we say we talk about a business, there are two sides to it, right? There's a give and a take. And you would be, your business rather would be having some product, service, or a process in it, which you would be offering to your customer. So it's an offering to your customer for which your customer will pay you back in terms of a financial give back, right? So when you're talking about a business, that's exactly what a business is all about, when it is a give and take, and there has to be an equal give and take in most cases. So what is your value proposition? So that is the first thing that you need to work upon. And what do you really mean by your value proposition? So what is it that your business, you need to describe your business. What is it? What is the value that you're offering to your customer? That's the first thing. And how do we translate that? Basically, we understand what need do you fulfill through your business, or what need will you fulfill through your business? That's one very important question you need to answer to yourself. And another thing is, what makes your business unique? I mean, this is what, so for example, when we talk about, say a brand, say, let's say, okay, you've heard of Kodak, right? The people who were making films for cameras. I mean, their value proposition was memories. They make memories for you, right? So likewise, Apple has a business proposition, and that's quality, right? Likewise, every other business has a business, has a value proposition that it offers. And you need to identify what is it going to be that you are going to offer as a value to your customer, for which your customer should know you and also be attached to you for a longer period of time. Also, you need to address one very big important question is, what is the problem that you are trying to solve? And that is very important, because only if you're trying to solve a problem will there be a need for your product. Generally, most products, I mean, are centered around a problem that they are trying to solve. So you need to describe your problem. What problems are you trying to solve through your business? It could be one problem, it could be a number of problems. Whose problem are you trying to solve? That is very important as well. When you're talking about a problem, just a problem will not help. It may be a problem in your eyes, may not be a problem in the eyes of your customer. But then whose problem are you trying to solve? If those are the people who consider that to be a problem, then yes, it's a problem. Otherwise, it is not considered to be a problem. And is it really a problem? When you say you're trying to solve a problem, are you thinking that this is a problem? Or does your customer feel that this is a problem? If you only feel that it's a problem, or only a small set of people feel that it's a problem, then it's probably not a problem worth solving. Or it's, I would say, it is not a problem putting your entire might behind, because you're going to run along with this business for a pretty long time, 10, 15, 20, 30 years. Would it be a problem to solve for the next 30 years? Is that big a problem? If yes, then it definitely requires your time behind it. That is, if you choose to solve this problem. You also need to answer another question is, if you're saying that it's a problem, then how big is that problem? I mean, does it affect, say, 100 people, 500 people, 5,000 people, 5 lakh people, 50 lakh people? The larger the problem, the longer the business would probably run, and the better the business, the stronger the business would probably run. If you have only a few takers for a solution, then that problem is not really worth solving. How effectively are you going to solve the problem? That is also very important. I mean, you're saying that you're going to solve the problem. How much of a difference are you going to make? Are you just going to make a very marginal difference to that, with your solution? Or is it going to be a huge solution that you have there? Are you going to really, is there a big delta between the problem and the solution? Is your problem going to have a great impact, or is it just going to be a slight impact? For example, somebody is solving the problem of, say, transportation, and you already have your Uber, Ulas and Ubers in place. How are you going to, if you're coming up with another cab service, what is the difference between you and your other people there? So how effectively are you going to solve it? Are you going to solve it just, marginally? Is it going to really make sense? Is your solution going to be accepted? How will people be really wanting to pay for that solution? That is another very big question. Yes, it may be a big problem that you're trying to solve. Yes, the solution may be acceptable as well. You may be solving it very effectively, but if nobody is willing to pay for it, it doesn't make any sense to solve that problem, because you're going to run a business, right? You need to also have a return for yourself. And that is the reason why you need to find out if people are willing to pay for a solution. For example, if you look at it, something like a YouTube, right? It's already there. It's for free. It's available. If you ask how many people do really want to actually pay for watching something on YouTube? So we need to really understand if it's going to be a business, then are people willing to pay for that business? Also, describe your solution. What is your solution? What is the solution that you're trying to provide to the people? You know, you need to ask yourself, how will the solution play out? You know, and how does the solution actually address the problem? That's also another very important point. How unique is your solution? I mean, are you just going to be yet another wannabe there? You know, like any other business, like an Ola or Uber, you are also coming out with a cab service, or is your solution very different? How unique is it? You also need to understand how big the market is. You're going to run with the problem for a longer period of time. In the sense, you're going to run a business for a longer period of time. If your market isn't big enough, you will not be able to sustain that business for long. You need to identify the market segment. You know, which is the market that you are trying to address? You need to identify that market very, very clearly. Is it going to be men? Is it going to be women? It is going to be families? Is it going to be a business that you're trying to solve this problem for? You need to identify where is your market. You need to understand how big is that market. And what is your penetration going to be like? As in, what part of the market are you going to capture? Are you going to just solve the problem for 1 or 2% of the market? Or are you going to try to look at a bigger chunk of the market? And what are the challenges to scale that business, to make that business grow? What will be the challenges like? You need to really look into these smaller aspects when you're talking about looking at a solution towards a problem. Also, you need to also work on your business model. What is your business model going to be like? Now, what do we mean by a business model? As in, how is my business going to be structured and how is it going to play out? And you need to ask some very important questions like, is my business scalable? Can I actually grow it? Today, I'm going to look at maybe 100 customers. Tomorrow, can I grow it to a 1 lakh customer base? Can I make this business expand? Can I go into a new geography? Today, I'm selling only in Kolkata, or I'm selling only in, say, Mumbai, or I'm selling only in India. Can I grow this? Can I take it to other countries? How scalable can I make my business? And what are my dependencies? What do I need to depend on? If I have to grow that business, then what am I going to depend on? Do I need other partners in the business? Do I need other people who are going to work for me in the business? Do I need money, funding that is? Do I need a bigger place? Do I need a bigger warehouse? What are my dependencies like? On what will my business, the growth of my business, depend upon? What are the key risks in my business? So an inclement weather going to be a risk to my business? I share a little anecdote here. Something that happened in my life. I was into leather accessories at one point in time. Started off manufacturing a brand. This was the first brand of leather accessories in the entire of the 11 states in Eastern India. 12 states rather. And we probably never even thought about it. I was running a factory where I was manufacturing leather belts. And it never struck to me, it never occurred to me that, weather could be a very, very major challenge. We all know water is a very major, an enemy of leather. Because leather is made in water, but once it's made, leather is the biggest enemy of leather. And it never occurred to me, or rather, I would never imagine that, there would be a flooding. There was in 2013, It was 23rd of October. It rained 166 millimeters of, I mean, we had 166 millimeters of rainfall overnight. It was a Friday night, Saturday night. And I could never imagine that my entire factory could get flooded, inundated, and my entire goods would get inundated in water. And that's exactly what happened. I lost 95% of my stocks. Everything finished in one day. And this was a major risk I wasn't ready for. My goods weren't insured at that point in time. So you need to also look at key risks. What can be the risks? And you are doing all this even before you're entering into a business, before even you're starting a business. You need to identify these key risks beforehand. I hadn't done that. Then another part is, how will you make money? And that's a part of your business model. If you cannot make money, and if it's not going to be a very profitable business, what's the point in doing the business, right? And a very important part again will also be, who are my competitors? Why is it important to know who are your competitors? You're going to do your business, you're going to maybe make a product and sell it. But why are competitors important? Well, competitors are important because the market is already overcrowded. There are already people selling some product or service there. Why will anybody want to, you know, switch over from something that they're already using or already buying to my product? And that would be the key question to answer. So who are your customers? So I need to understand who are my customers. I need to understand what are my customers doing. So key questions, who is your competition? I mean, who are your customers? There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 10, 20, how many? And it, you know, your competition could change. I mean, it could be from time to time, it could change as well. And also, what is the perspective? Are you looking at just your country? Are you looking at the international markets? So competition could change there. If I'm only going to be in my country for some more time, say the next 5 years, or I'm only going to have decided I'm only going to sell in my own country, not outside, then it's fine. I know the competition is within my country. But when I talk about going abroad, or other, you know, taking my product to other countries, then automatically the competition landscape changes. It becomes much bigger. And then we need to understand, you know, how does, I mean, whatever I'm making, what is the solution that I'm offering? How does it compare to the solutions of others? How does my product or service compare to the product or services of other competitors? And that's a very, very important aspect that one needs to look into, because you need to really understand, are you offering enough value, or is your value greater than the value of being offered by the others? And that is exactly why we make out a competition landscape, or in, as in, you know, try and understand what really are the features of my product, what is the value that I'm offering, which is not being offered by others. And that really helps to understand, what am I going to manufacture? When you are at the beginning of your, I mean, when you're starting off the business, if you know exactly this is the value that is being offered by competitors, and there is a gap here, then I can fill in this gap. If you can identify that, then automatically, you know, you have a very good business case there. However, that gap needs to be a very important gap. It needs to be a very big gap. It is something that you are trying to give to the customer, which the customer really wants. And there is no one else, you know, ready with that solution at this point in time. Another very important question. Why should my customers, or why should customers opt for my solution? I mean, if they're already buying, say, suppose I'm talking about, again, a cab service, if they're already using an Uber, Ola and an Uber, why will they want to shift over to mine, my service? Why will they want to download my app at all in the very first place? What is it that I am offering which is much greater, or which is much more attractive to my customers than what the competition is already doing? I hope this, you know, is helpful to understand competitors. I see there are about 12 questions right now in the chat box. Please do keep putting in your questions if you have any questions. I will come back to your questions at the end of the session. So moving on, one very important aspect of your business is also going to be your team. Because if you ask anyone today, they'll tell you that a business can fail, but a team should not. The team should be resilient, and the team should be robust. And if that is there, then it's very difficult for a business to also fail. So a very good team is very important. And that's the reason why you need to understand, I mean, when you are planning your business, you need to plan your team as well. So is your team competent? So who are your team members, first of all? And what do they bring to the table? What does each team member bring to the table? Is the team member, what are the qualifications of the of each of the team members? And what role are they going to play in the business? That is very important. When we talk about competency, we talk about experience, we talk about knowledge, we talk about skill sets. These are all very important, so it could be what is the course that they've done, or what is the qualification that they have. Have they done any other courses which are beyond that of their studies? Have they picked up any skill sets? Have they got any certifications that they've taken? Do they have another degree, a professional degree, to their resume? Or you could say that, have they worked anywhere before? Have they picked up any experience? Is that experience relevant to my business? Whoever I'm trying to involve in my team. So team formation is a very important part of a business. And the founders or the co-founders in a business, first of all, a founder needs to find another co-founder in a business. It is difficult to run along with a business in a business alone. Generally, we always say have another co-founder or a set of co-founders so that, you know, you're not alone, number one. Number two, you have enough competencies in the core body of the team. Okay, the core body is the team of people who own the business. Okay, employees don't own the business. They only, if you're giving them shares and they only own a certain part of the business, but the major part of the business is owned by co-founders. So if you're saying that you first need to have a co-founder or a set of co-founders in the business. So when you're choosing them, you need to choose them with care. So these are very important. So is your team competent enough? Is your team complete? As in, if suppose somebody's going to look after finance, somebody's going to look after marketing, somebody's going to look after HR, somebody's going to look after the business operations. So is my team complete? And what would really do we need? So that means, do we need 10 people in the team to handle everything? No, it could be that one person could be handling maybe two things also. It could also be that in the initial beginning, you may not have the entire core team handling everything, but you may have some employees as well. That can also happen. So the employees would take care of some of the responsibilities. The core areas are generally depending upon what your business is. For example, if I'm going to open a business of, say, food delivery through an app, then the core part of my business would be the app, the technology. Then I would really want that somebody from, who knows how to build an app or run an app or, look after or manage an app should be a part of my core team. And that would be a very, very important part. If I'm going to make the deliveries myself, then I would want an operational guy to be on the team itself, who's going to handle the delivery part, of the food. So these are very important, Then if I need to have partnerships in place with restaurant owners, which is the key core part of the business, because they are going to, make the food, then I need somebody from the HR side or from the marketing side, maybe a marketing guy who could, go out and actually talk to restaurant owners and tie up with them. So these are 2-3 people who will be important. I could take, rather handle one part of these 3 functions, and I could have maybe 2 other co-founders. So this could be a way of working out. Does your team have the necessary experience? And that's also very important. Have they worked before in another organization or another business similar to this? May not be the same, but similar to this, or handling the same function, if not in a similar business. So these are things that you need to answer about a team. Then you also need to have a very clear understanding about your customer segment. Who is my customer? And that's a very important part, because not everything is made for everyone. You need to understand, who are you going to sell to? So in the very beginning, you need to actually identify your customer. So who is your customer or customers? Now, you can define your customer by various methodologies, okay? It could be, gender, it could be place or location or geography, it could be age. You could say, I've got customers from the age of 25 to 40, okay? You could say that, my customers are, male or female. My customers are, businessmen, or my customers are service people. My customers could be also in the socioeconomic segment, somebody who's got a credit card. you know, those kind of things. The more you define your customer and to the depth and detail in which you define your customer, the more clarity you will have as to who am I selling to. So accordingly, your solution or whatever you're trying to sell, your product or service, can be customized to that level, right? Then are these people, are my customers people or are they businesses? Yesterday we heard about a B2B and a B2C or a business to business or a business to customer approach with the entrepreneurs who were there yesterday. And so this is what you need to identify. Are you selling directly to the customer who are individuals, or are you selling to another business which becomes a customer for you? Because both are very different. The approach will be very different because they will be present very in different places. When you're talking about B2C as in business to customer who are individuals, I mean, the whole world could be a customer. Of course, I'm saying that, that's on a very loose end, but the entire strategy to reach out to them will be very different from reaching out to a business who's a customer. So you need to really understand who is it that you're building the product or service for, and what are the characteristics of the customer? What are the tastes, preferences, the likes, dislikes, cultural, cultural habits, or you could say religious habits. These all, there could be many others, but these all actually impact the way you will be dealing with them, the way you will be reaching out to them, the way you will be engaging with them. All this will depend upon the characteristics of the customer. So you really need to define the customer segment. And by a segment, we mean, is it like a particular segment of customers, like you're talking about, either you're talking about individual customers, you're talking about businesses, it could also be a government who can be a customer for you. My product is only majorly made for the government, or the government would be the best way to reach other people is through the government. So the government would be probably a better way, or it could be a corporate who could be a customer. So depending upon who your customer is intended to be, you can actually segment it. For example, I'll just give you an example. If you're making stationery, individuals can be a customers, right? But at the same time, you could also say that I will only sell to government organizations, or my stationery is only made for, say, executives who are working in organizations, or for people in business or service. So now the whole scenario changes. It is the same product, maybe slightly customized, maybe, but the entire scenario changes. When I have to reach out to a customer who's an individual, I'll have to look at ways and means, like, maybe through a retail shop, maybe through a stationery shop, it could be a departmental store, it could be the internet as in an e-commerce site. But it could be a very different scenario for, say, if I have to look at only businesses. I don't need a retail shop to go to a business. If I have to sell to a Reliance or to, say, a Vodafone or to an Airtel, all I need to do is directly go to them, to their offices. Or if I have to sell to the government, then I will go to government offices. So there's and the way to reach out to them will be very different then. And another very important part is the customer relationship. So now you know who your customer is, but you also need to know what kind of a relationship is it that you want to establish with the customer. So how will you interact and engage with your customer? That is very important. I mean, is it going to be through a phone call? Is it going to be through a personal visit? Is it going to be through social media? I mean, that is very important, because that will decide as to how the entire business flow will take place. How will you really define the contours of your business? Also, you need to understand, or rather make, is a user journey map. So how will you, when you say, how are you going to engage with or interact with your customer? Is it that you will first, try and, attract your customer through, a social media handle, and then the customer, how will you deal with that customer? So the customer will actually place an order either on, through a WhatsApp message, or will he go through an app, or will he go through, or she go through a website, or will he or she go through a e-commerce platform? So now the whole journey changes, right? So you need to actually map out. So this is how the journey of the customer and the engagement with the customer will be. Then how will we deliver the product to the customer? And then how will we receive the feedback from the customer? And then how will we go back to the customer once again after this one sale? How will I entice the customer to come back to me again? So this entire journey needs to be mapped out. And how will the payments be received? Is it going to be through a website? Are we selling through a retail store? Then it'll be us to a wholesaler, wholesaler to a retailer, retailer to a customer. So that journey really needs to be mapped out, because that will decide what are the activities in your business. Right? What are the points of engagement with the customer? How many times will you engage with your customer? At what juncture? And at what timing? What will be the timing of that engagement within that customer journey? You know, so that is very important, because that will give you the time and the duration to which how long that engagement will be for. And how many, when you say what are the touch points, and you know how many times you are getting an opportunity to engage with the customer. So that could mean a number of things. It could mean the first interaction could be when you are launching a campaign to advertise about your customer. So to make your customer aware that you are there in this world. Another opportunity could be when the customer comes back to you for a sale, when the customer places an order. The next could be when you send the goods to the customer. The fourth could be when the customer makes a payment to you. So all these are different touch points. And at different touch points, there are different value propositions that you offer to the customer. So there'll be different engagement. There will be a different, what are you giving back to the customer at that point in time, that proper one specific moment? Is it going to be an opportunity where you can actually convey something to the customer, or is it an opportunity where you can take something from the customer? So all these touch points actually decide how you will engage, interact, and what will be the life cycle of your interaction with the customer. Now, also very important is to understand when we are talking about selling to the customer, how is it that we're going to reach out to the customer for a sale? In the sense, is it going to be through a channel? How many hands is the product going to change or the service going to change before it reaches the customer? So you need to first understand for that, where are your customers? So if my customer is sitting far away from me, how do I reach my customer with my product? And that is a very important part. For example, I'll tell you, suppose you're manufacturing, say, washing machines. There are many ways of reaching out to your customer, right? So suppose you are sitting in Mumbai and your customer is sitting in, say, Chennai. How do you sell your product to your customer? And who will actually deliver the product? There could be many in-betweens you and the customer. So one way is that you sell the product through a e-commerce site. Another way is that you make distributors in various regions of the country and say, okay, for North, I've got one distributor in South, you've got one East and one West. Now these distributors could further have retailers under them, as in last mile stores who would be selling this washing machine. So now that is, so the channel would be you to the distributor to the retailer. Now suppose your business is small in the beginning, this would be fine. But when it grows really large, then selling directly to distributor may not be able to handle so many retailers. Then what? Then you may need to have a stockist. Somebody or the distributor may not be able to have that kind of storage space, because a washing machine is a very large item in terms of volume. So then how do we, it's a very bulky item. So how do we go about this? So distributor says, I'm sorry, but I don't have that kind of space. I don't have a warehouse. And I can't handle that part at all, because that's in itself will be, stock management will be a bigger part. So then you might have to have a stockist in that region, somebody who will stock only the products there. And whenever a distributor requires the product, she will be able to actually deliver it from there. And you may also have maybe not one, maybe have four distributors in a particular region. Say North region, you've got four distributors because now the territory is so large, one distributor cannot handle it. Then you will definitely need somebody to deliver the product to these distributors. And that could be a stockist. So this is how, you know, businesses evolve and grow. And how will you reach your customer? So that's another very important point. Are you going to reach your customer through, you know, an advertisement, through a social media handle? Are you going to reach your customer through a website, through an e-commerce platform? Or is it going to be through a retailer? You know, so all these are different formats. So once you decide all that, all this actually makes up the sales channel, what we call channels. Right. So this is a very important aspect when you are trying to plan your business. Then what are the various activities that your business will undertake in order to, you know, offer that or take that value from you to your customer? So important questions are, what activities will my business undertake? And what do we mean by these activities? So am I going to manufacture goods? Or am I just going to trade? Am I going to pick up goods from some other manufacturer and then sell them? Or am I going to pick up some products which are white labeled, as in they don't have any branding on it? I'll just pick those up, just package it under my brand, put a sticker to it, and then sell. That's another way of doing business. Another way of doing business could be that I manufacture the product myself, and then I sell it. Another way of doing business could be that I give out the manufacturing to somebody else on my behalf. Another way of doing business could be that I could get parts from different manufacturers and assemble them at my place. I could also break down my product into, say, two or three parts and say, okay, you do a component. You know, I give it to somebody and say, you do this component and give it back to me. And I'll take three components from three different people. And those three components can be put together to make my product. So now that is another way of doing a business. So what will be the activities that my business will undertake? So manufacturing is one. Getting the product in hand, that is one, right? Then there could be, how am I going to sell it? So what are the activities that are required to sell the product? So am I going to do marketing around the product? Am I going to run campaigns? That's an activity again. How am I going to send the product to my house? So I'm going to transport the product, right? That's another activity. I need to collect payments. That's another activity. So different activities you need to list out that your business is going to, and the key activities that your business is going to undertake in order to offer the value to your customer. What will be the key resources used to conduct the business? What do we mean by this? Key resources. So for example, I need to have, say, employees. That's a resource, right? I need to have raw material. That is a resource. I need to have, funding. That's a resource. So what are the key resources that will be required for me to conduct my business? I need to list that down as well. And what will be the time taken for all these to reach me? For example, initially, if I want funding, how long will it take to get that funding? How long will it take for me to get the raw materials? How long will it take for me to hire people? Because all this will decide when are you going to begin the business, your plan for the business, a timeline that you can put to things. What will be the expertise required? Do I really need to know manufacturing myself if I'm going to manufacture, or am I going to hire people? So what expertise do I require? Do I need to have knowledge of the product? Do I need to have the knowledge of the technical aspects of the product? Do I need to have the knowledge of the business aspects of the product? Or do I need to have finance knowledge? Do I need to have knowledge to do marketing or to do branding? Or am I going to give out branding to a third party to do it? So what are the expertise that I require to do this business? And if I don't have them, do I need to acquire those expertise? You know, so all this is very important to list out. How will the product be distributed? How will I sell it? How will I send it to my customer? How will it reach my customer? Between me and the customer, what are the different legs? Is it going to go through a wholesaler, a retailer, and then through a delivery van to a customer, or is it going to, I mean, the customer is going to come and purchase it from a retailer, or is it going to be ordered over e-commerce platform? So how's the distribution going to take place? So those are very important. For example, I'm going to send the goods from here to, say, Chennai to my customer. It will go through, the roadways, okay? So a truck will actually carry it from one place to the other. But once it reaches Chennai, then how is it going to be distributed to the customer again? Then is it going to be an Ola or Swiggy, or is it going to be a delivery guy who's going to deliver it? Or is it going to be through some other means that we are, or are we going to invite the customer to come back and collect the product? So it all depends upon how your product is placed and what are you thinking about your product. Is there any technical development that is required in the product? For example, I'm going to make, a washing machine, and I've decided that my washing machine is going to work on solar. Now, is there any technical development required? Do I need, can I just pick up a photovoltaic cell and put it across the side of my washing machine and say it's going to work? Or do I need to actually technically develop something that is not there? Or does it require a proper motor which is going to work on solar, so it needs some conversion somewhere? So do I need to have a technical development there? So if that be the case, then that will be also part of my key activities. And all these activities, once I'm sure of that these make up my business, then only can I understand how much of time it will take, what cost it will require, what resources it will require. All this will actually help me to plan my business. What are the key resources, that will be required? So by key resources, like I just explained a little while ago, key resources can be funding, key resources can be manpower, it can be your raw material, it could be a sales network. What human resource will be required? Now we're looking at something a little more deeper. How many sales agents do we require? Do we need feet on street to go out and actually talk to people about the product? Do I need a salesman? Do I need a marketing manager? Do I need an HR guy? As in a HR, if I'm going to have a huge team, say I'm going to have 200 salesmen, then I need maybe a marketing manager and over and above them, or I need maybe 4 marketing managers, because one will not be able to handle all 40 or 50 or 200. So maybe one can handle about 50 people. So about 4 marketing managers I will require. Then what do I need? I need now an HR person as well, because I've got so many people. So automatically the human resource element, somebody needs to handle that. Their payments are there, their grievances are there, their salaries are there, their reimbursements are there, their travel is there, so much to be looked after. I will also require a finance person, because there's so many people now, so many transactions taking place. I need somebody who can handle my finance. I need somebody who can handle my accounts, So these are all different kinds of resources, the human resources that we require. I might also require, menial labor loading and offloading of goods. And maybe I'll require that at the warehouse level or at the factory level. I may need to hire some people on my rolls, or I could even have them coming in on a daily wage basis. But I need to decide that. What infrastructure will be required? That is also a very important key resource. For example, if I'm manufacturing, washing machines, then I need a big manufacturing plant. So it means it needs space, it needs machinery, it needs electricity, it needs water, it needs a constant source of electricity, It could also require another infrastructure for a little space for handling the product or service, which might be an open field. I need probably space for parking of trucks. That could be also a part of the infrastructure. Right, I may require maybe a weighing machine to make sure that all my goods are weighed and sent, so I know how much to calculate for my transportation or labor or whatever. So all those are part of the infrastructure. Then who are going to be my key partners? Who are my key partners? And that's a very important part. We cannot do business alone, right? It is, inappropriate to think that any business can thrive alone. No, you can't. You need to have partners who are going to help you at every little step. One can't do everything on one's own. So for example, if I'm into manufacturing, my core area is manufacturing. I would want to focus my time, effort, energy only on manufacturing. Okay, at the max, once the product has been manufactured, I will package it and I'll put it off. But I wouldn't want to get into logistics. I wouldn't want to transport that product from my place to, the railways or to some other city. I wouldn't want to have trucks of my own. It doesn't make sense, right? So I will need a partner. I will need a logistics partner who's going to handle all the logistics. And once my business grows, maybe I will also require somebody to, now the packaging. Packaging, I may not manufacture myself. I will only package the product, but somebody else will manufacture it and give it to me. Now that becomes my partner. The guy who's manufacturing my packaging, my tags, my stickers, my labels. I don't need to manufacture them. I can't put up an industry for everything, right? So I will have partners who are going to do the other parts for me. And those other parts will all come together and make that one big whole. So I could be, my core forte might just be, say, developing the motor for my washing machine. I can manufacture that one motor. That could be my model. Another model could be, I could say that I will manufacture the motor, but the body will be supplied to me by somebody else. And that becomes my partner. Or maybe I will say, I'll do all the mechanical parts myself. The digital parts will be supplied to me by somebody. I don't need to manufacture an IC, an integrated circuit, right? So for example, a mobile manufacturer is not going to sit down and make ICs. There are maybe 20 ICs in a phone. They will not make the ICs. They will just order it from somebody else. So that the supplier will become a partner to you. Okay? So who are the key partners required to deliver the value to the customer? And that's a very important question. You need to first decide, because once you decide who your partners are, will only come out from the fact that what are the activities that you're going to have, right? From those activities, you know who are my key partners, because then you will decide as to, this is the operation part that I will do. This is what I will not do. The rest will come from partners. Okay. And that will decide the scale of your business. That will decide the intricacy of your business. It will decide what you need in your business. At what juncture of the business are they required? As in, the partners may be required at different times during the span of the business. Somebody may be required at the very early stage of manufacturing. For example, I may need a partner to sell raw materials to me. Without raw material, I can't even start off the business, start of the manufacturing activity, right? But an IC may be required at a very later stage of the production cycle, right? It might just be required at the end when I need to just plug in that IC and actually test the product and send it off. So I need to understand that, because that will give me an understanding also of when my money will be required. At what point in time, how much of money will I require? So I need not have everything with me at one go, right? And what are the other requirements that I may have which are connected to some key partners? For example, with a key partner, I need, say, a delivery van to come to me to deliver the product. For example, the cartons. Okay, which are going to be used for packaging. That's not required right now. It's required at a much later stage or cycle of the product. And I will only deploy that key partner at that point in time. So my cost to that will also be deployed at that point in time. Let's move on from key partners to cost structures. Okay, now, what are cost structures? So basically, you're going to manufacture, or you're going to trade, you're going to sell a product or service, but you need to also have a very good understanding of what is the cost to each one of those pieces, so that you can come up with your cost, your total cost. Only when you know your total cost can you decide upon your price of the product, because in between the cost and the price is something called your profit. Your profit is your margin that you will require to make. Only when you know your costs can you decide the price. Okay? Now, let's look at the costs. How much will it cost to achieve these key activities? So, for example, manufacturing is one part. So, product manufacturing will be one cost. Product packaging will be one cost. Then there will be a cost for, delivery of the product to the from the warehouse till the the railway station, and the railways will transport the goods, suppose. Then one cost will also be the cost of freight on train. And then once it lands there in the other city, then the product needs to be transported by road again to the warehouse of my distributor. So that's also another cost. then the distributor will keep a margin to sell that product. That is also part of my cost, right? Then the distributor will send it to the retailer. That transportation again is another cost. Then the retailer will keep some margin. That's also part of the cost, right? Then there'll be other costs also to the business. For example, if I'm going to do some advertising, that's another cost. I'm going to do some sampling, as in give free samples to people. That is another cost. There is a cost to my setup, for example, my factory, my rent, my electricity, water charges. All this is cost. The people that I'm hiring, that's a part of the cost. There will be some labor. That's a part of the cost. So away from the manufacturing, there could be other labor, there could be other resources, human resources that are involved. Say my accountant's salary, that's not part of the manufacturing cost, but that's still a part of the cost that will be attributed to the total cost of the product, right? And how do we do this? So I'll say, okay, I'm going to manufacture 10,000 pieces in a year. Right? So I will take all the other costs, which are overheads or what we call incidental costs and overhead costs. Overheads are like your rent, electricity, your human resource or salaries, all that is a part of the overhead, right? Because it is not part of the manufacturing cost. It is over and above the manufacturing cost. But those need to be attributed. So you'll say, okay, in 1 year's time, I'm going to spend so much of rent, so much on electricity, so much on mobile phones and telephones, so much on logistics, so much on salaries and everything. I'll add up all that. I'll add up the cost of 10,000 pieces. I'll add up all the margins that I'm going to give to my retailer, my wholesaler, my distributor. I'll add up all the transportation, logistic costs there. I'll add up all that and divide that by 10,000. That will give me the cost of one piece. Now, once I know that cost of one piece, I can say, okay, if my cost is coming to 2,000 rupees, then I want to make 20% profit. So I will add 20% to it and then sell it. And if 2,000 is my cost, 20% is 400 rupees, so my selling price will be 2,400 rupees. And suppose at any given point in time, I want to give a discount to say 5%, then that 5% will go out from there. So this is how you actually calculate your cost. And that is very important. If you don't know your costs, you will never be able to do business because you will never be able to make a profit. So there are different kinds of costs or key resources, partnerships that need to be included. How much will it cost to deliver the value to the product, as in it could be the delivery cost, it could be the cost for logistics. What will be the additional cost to run the business? We just discussed that. And what will be the cost to, this is one cost that nobody adds, and this is very important. What will be the cost to hire the co-founders? Now, what do we mean by this? Suppose it is my business. Okay, I have another co-founder in the business. There are two of us. Now, we need to be compensated for the time that we are also spending in the business. It's not all about passion. It is, yes, about passion, but then I need to remunerate myself. Otherwise, how will I run my house? So, for that, I need to pay myself a salary or take a certain part of the profits out of the business. And I need to account for all that in my costings, as to what are the co-founders going to earn. And each year that could change. You could say, okay, we will take 20,000 rupees each month, both of us, in the first year. In the second year, we will increase that to 25,000 or 30,000. Or if our business goes well and we do say 200% growth, then we will take it up to 30,000 rupees. You know, something like that. Another part, how will the business make money? That is one very important aspect about business. How will the business make money? If we don't know, so we need to understand how is it that we're going to make money? What do I mean by that? Are we going to sell a product and make money? Are we going to take a subscription on a particular service and make money? Are we going to take a commission on some of our sales through another platform and then make money? We need to decide that. How is that my business is going to make the money? What are the different avenues of making money? Now, to give you an example, how are the... okay, let's say I'm going to manufacture and sell sugarcane juice. Okay, so if I ask you how am I going to make money, you're going to say, obviously you're going to sell the sugarcane juice and make money. Yes, that's one way of making money. There are other ways of making money as well. There could be another avenue. For example, when I make sugarcane, I'll have a lot of waste material called bagasse left. Okay, that's a crushed sugarcane. What do I do that with that? Can that be used in any other industry? Yes, it can be used for making, say, fabric. Bagasse is being used to make fabric. So can I sell that to somebody who's a fabric manufacturer and make money? Yes, that could be a way of doing. That is another avenue of making money. Right? Another way of making money could be, say, I put up, what else? Let's say you're selling sugarcane juice. One way is direct sales, one way of making money. Another way of making money is I could supply sugarcane to, say, another industry. That is another way of making money. I could say that when I'm extract sugarcane, I could make, sugar out of it also. And that could be my long-term plan, that after 3 years, I will set up a sugar plant. That means from sugarcane, I will sell sugarcane juice and partly I will make sugar out of it. That's another way of making money. Now, when I'm going to make sugar, I will have something called molasses left with me probably. That is, if I sell those molasses, I will make money. So you need to find out as to whether different avenues of making money. Now, what will be the pricing of the product? That is also very important. Will I keep a 20% margin? Or do I need to keep 30% and offer a discount of 5%? So how will I price my product? Now, my pricing of my product, a lot of things it will be dependent upon. Who is my target customer? That will decide also whether my pricing is right for them or not. I'm trying to sell a 2,000 rupee shoe to somebody who lives in a slum. Do you think that is going to work? It's not going to work. Do you think a 2,000 rupee shoe will be accepted by general public? No. So I might have to look for a different clientele, or I might have, if my target is a very niche clientele which will be buying a shoe for 2,000 rupees, yes, it makes sense. So when I'm doing my pricing, a lot of factors will come into play. One will be the cost. The other part will also be who am I trying to sell this to. That will decide my pricing. For some price brackets, it just might not work if you keep too low a pricing. So if an iPhone would be selling for 10,000 or 15,000 rupees, do you think it might sell? It would sell? It may not have sold. It sells at maybe 90,000 rupees or a lakh of rupees or 80,000 rupees and sells very well. It's probably because the pricing gives us an understanding, yes, this is a valuable product. There's value in the product. Now the same product can be made by a Samsung. But when you compare, a Samsung sells for 40,000 while an iPhone sells for a lakh of rupees or a 90,000 rupees. Why? What can be so different in that? Okay, there could be a marginal difference in technology, but the pricing is probably not because of the technology. The pricing is because of the branding. So you need to understand how are you going to price your product and who is it going to be for? And that is also going to play an important part besides the cost of your product. What will be the profit of your business? I'm sorry, there's a grammatical error there. What will be the profit of your business? So you need to understand that as well. If I'm going to make 20% profit, is that profit going to suffice for me? What can be the other unforeseen expenses that will come up? Say maybe you have to give a discount twice a year. You are selling through an e-commerce site. Every 3 months they come up with a sale, a big sale. And they expect you to participate in that. And they expect you to give a 5 to 7% discount or a 10% or 20% off. Now, Have you calculated that? If you've not calculated that, because that is going to eat on your profits because you've not calculated it. So do I need to keep my profits a little more than what I'm thinking of right now? Is 20% good enough? Is 30% good enough? Will it be able to cover for those sales 3 times a year? So when you are doing your pricing, you need to keep all these factors in mind. So I come to the end of my part here. There's one more part which I'm not touching, and that is the revenue, as in the finances part. Where is the funding going to come in from? That is not very relevant right now, so we'll leave that out right now. Okay. So at this point in time, we will only look at these aspects of a business plan. Otherwise, what would have happened was I would have also taken on that. Where is the funding going to come from? How am I going to raise that funding? It's probably not relevant right now. Yeah. So let's look at the questions. Or Shwayu, what do you suggest? How should we go about the questions?
Gaurav, first of all, thank you so much for the session. I personally loved it. Even as a co-founder, I find myself taking notes because a lot of what you said is so, so relevant when you're running a real, real startup. So I think students today have had a wonderful, wonderful session. Thank you so much for that.
Thank you.
We will take some of the questions that have come in. There are quite a few. We'll just try and answer the questions that have, you know, come a few times repeatedly so that we can cover those broad areas.
Yeah.
One question that was asked yesterday as well, can two already running products be combined into one? And will it be a good business idea?
I couldn't get that. Could you repeat that, please?
Sure. Can two already running products be combined into one? And will it be a good business idea?
Okay. So it depends upon whether they are complementary products or not. For example, say Joydeep is making bicycles. And say Suman is making locks for bicycles or seat covers for bicycles. They can be sold individually as two different products, but they are complementing to each other. If they come together, how does the scenario look like? I've given you two examples. One is a lock and one is a seat cover. Now, is it essential as a part of the product, like a lock? Well, we all will assume that, yes, whoever is buying a bicycle will require a lock. And generally, every other person who buys a bicycle goes out and buys a lock, you know, along with it on the very same day because you want safety for your bicycle. So it would be a good idea probably. Also, if you look at the seat cover, a lot of people may not want to buy a seat cover. It's not a necessary thing for a bicycle because there's already a seat there. So it may not be a very good idea. But also keeping in mind when you're saying combining the two products, you're not talking about, you only said about the products. You never spoke about the interests of the two founders. Now, if suppose Joydeep is manufacturing and selling a bicycle, the value of the bicycle will be much more than the value of a lock. So automatically, if they come together, I mean, they will have to be sharing profits in maybe some kind of a ratio because they're not equally valuable. But yes, they can come together if it makes sense because they are very, very complementing products and they can't go without each other. I think it would be a very good idea. But whoever has asked that question, if you could, give me an example by what are you really asking, aiming at, then probably it'd be a better idea to answer it that way directly.
Wonderful. So Adya, if you want more details on that answer, why don't you drop us a mail and we'll perhaps be able to get into more details. I'm sure you don't want to discuss your entry in front of all your competitors right now. Well, there are quite a few questions about scaling.
Yeah.
How can a business be scalable, etc., with a particular focus on what does scaling mean for digital products, a website or an app? Could you just spend a couple of minutes on that?
Yeah. So when we talk about scaling, the primary objective of scaling is to reach out to more people, to grow your market, right? That is the objective of scaling. And how do you scale that? So basically you're saying that, you want to grow your market and you could grow your market in the same geography. For example, I have got 5,000 customers in Kolkata territory, or I've got 5,000 customers in, say, Mumbai territory. I can scale them up. I will need to put in some effort behind scaling that to maybe 10,000 customers or 20,000 customers, because I know the customers are there. So I can scale within the same territory. Another way of scaling could be, I scale from Mumbai to other parts of the state of Maharashtra. That is also scaling, right? You could even broaden that and say, okay, I want to scale to more parts in the country. That means I will add on more states. I'll go state by state. I'm doing Maharashtra. The next one, right next to it is Gujarat, is a very good state for me. Seems to be a good market. Let me expand there. So that is scaling again. So you could scale both in terms of geography and in actual numbers also. That is two. Now when you're talking about a digital product, scaling would mean, now, how do you scale is another question. One way of doing it is increasing your, now since we've spoken about it, your customer segments. That is one way. Another way of scaling is, how do you reach out to your customers? So those, if you increase, for example, I am only selling through an e-commerce site. Now I will sell through a retail store as well. That is scaling, that is going to help you to scale, right? Now, another way of doing it is, if it's a digital product, do I need to, I just have a website. Do I really need to have an app? Will the app help me to, you know, come closer to my customer? Am I offering anything more than what I'm offering on my website, or is it the same? If I'm going to launch an app, it means a cost. It means some time, effort, energy behind it. It means also, zeroing down on a particular customer who uses a smartphone. So am I going to do that? That is going to be the activity to scale. But scaling is not necessarily having an app for a digital product. That is the means, or the via media way by which you scale. But then if you are coming up with an app, then you need to make sure that that app is also downloaded and installed into more number of mobile handsets. How do you do that? What will be your strategy to do that? And that is customer acquisition. How will you reach out to your customer? How will you make sure that you convert your customer? Just by making an app is not enough. There are a lot more things behind making a successful product or a service. You need to make people, and today, let me tell you, I think it's true for all of us, if you're not blinded by the magnetism of an app, but for all our mobile phones, we now weigh as to what we are downloading. This is real estate on your phone. You don't download anything and everything today. A lot of people download and then just delete it because they find no value in it. So this is extremely important, real estate space on phones. So just developing an app is not enough, I would say. It is also very important, what would be your strategy behind taking this app to people, how to get people to download it, number one, how to make them use it. Even if they download it, they may not want to use it. How do you get that going? And which means a whole lot of an exercise around it. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Gaurav, with your permission, if I may add to that, there's one particular question on scalability. Like Gaurav said, that's scaling. And scalability in terms of a digital product, to give you our own example at Notebook, before the lockdown started, we were at somewhere around 700,000 users. Within a few months, we've grew to 2.5 million users. And within that time, the problem was, how scalable is the product? How will it cater to that larger audience? The way to do that for a digital product is have your architecture on the cloud. Most cloud services, be it Azure or AWS or Google Cloud, allow you phenomenal amount of scalability, right? Unlike a physical server, where after a certain number of users, you have to add on more hardware. Cloud-based services allow you more scale. So I think in terms of scalability of a digital solution, do look at that architecture bit. It'll help you. Gaurav, there's a very interesting question, and this comes from a teacher at DPSMIS Qatar, who asked, do you think that these many points actually could be explained and presented within 7 minutes of time? This comes down to the business end of our event.
Thank you so much, whoever this is, ma'am, sir, whoever. I must first of all thank you for asking such an important question, and I think it's a very valid question. Well, okay. The answer is no. And you would be surprised with this answer, because after having delivered a session which is an hour long and I come and say no, you would say, am I joking? No. I'll tell you the reason why I have been through so much in detail. This is only to open up the, I would say, the mind and to get people to understand how things work. Okay, so in this session, we're talking about how to make a business plan. So I have oriented everybody on how to make it and what would go into it. How much of thought can go into starting off a business? And how much do you need to prepare yourself? How much do you need to plan? And giving you an overview of 360 degree view of how a business actually runs. Because if you get this part, then you know how a business runs, right? Or what goes in the back end of the business? How does a business run? So all this actually goes into set up a business. However, when you're talking about pitching or for 7 minutes, that we will come to tomorrow. What to include, what not to include, what can you talk about, what you can't talk about, how much of time can you spend on what, how to present it, we'll come tomorrow.
Thanks for that. There are quite a few questions on the team part, right? How do you identify what competencies, should we talk about designations, etc.? Do you want to kind of quickly get over the team bit in a broad way?
Okay. Very honestly speaking, a team is like a family, right? You need a mother, a father, children, So it's like everybody is doing their bit. A team is exactly like that. You need to have people who want to do their bit. Now, there are two parts to the team. One part is the core team, which is we're talking about the founders and the co-founders. And the other parts of the team are the people you hire in your business, right? Now, this entire team is going to run the business. Now, when you're talking about selection or, inviting people to come and join you, you need to look at a few things that you feel, like I said before, are very important to the business. Some will be core to the business, which you will definitely want in the core team. And some things will be, secondary, which you can even have in your employees. So there are two things that you look out for. One is, what are the functions that each of these team members can actually deliver on the table? And these functions could be marketing, finance, HR, product development or operations, all this. Okay. Now you have to see which are the ones which are core to your business. And then you take that up into the core team, which is the founders and the co-founders. And the rest of the functions you can leave within the employee base and say, okay, I will hire a person who's going to do who's going to be a marketing manager, who's going to look after this part of it. But of course, you need somebody above that marketing manager to also understand who this decides this strategy bit. And that is exactly what the core team does. A lot of the strategy, or most part of the strategy, is done within the core team itself. Right? Now, when you're talking about selections, there's a way of doing it. You need to, of course, talk to people. You really need to understand who's what and what they can, bring to the table, and what is the value that they're going to offer for the life of the business. That is what is that you're really trying to understand, right? That's it.
Wonderful. I think that's one of the best ways I have heard team for a startup explained. There are quite a few questions on the marketing bit as well. There are apprehensions as in, what if the segment does not respond to my product? How do I get people to know about my product? Do you want to spend a couple of minutes on the communications?
Yes. So when you're talking about marketing, first of all, when you are actually looking at or identifying a product, at that very level, you understand a lot of things. You look at the market, you look at what is the problem. That's why I said we focus a lot on the problem statement. What is it that you're trying to solve? Which problem are you going to, which challenge are you trying to solve? The other part is, what is the industry doing today? Who are the other competitors in the business? And what is the value that you are going to offer to? If you have followed whatever I have spoken about today, you will understand that each one of them actually fits in very well in identification of the right product or service that you're going to do your business in. Once you've identified that and you've looked at the market, you've done a survey, you've done a validation, you've gone to your customers, spoken to them, understood what is it that they require, then zeroing down onto a product or a service is much simpler. And the chances of making a mistake are much lesser because you've already spoken to your customer and it's a large base that you've spoken to. So the more validations that you do, the stronger is your response. And the better becomes your product development or service. So once you do that, and then when you're talking about marketing, when you're marketing a product, why would a product fail in the marketing? Either the way you're marketing it is not right, or the product is not right, or you're not being able to reach the market. You need to reach the right product to the right guy. And that is a very important part, because once the product has already been defined, the product has already been made, it has been manufactured. Now, if you're going to the market, you need to set a very good strategy to reach out to the right person at the right time when the need is there. If you can identify that, you can figure out your way out around it. Well, I don't think there's any problem there. Yeah.
Wonderful. Last one. I find this a very interesting question. It says, is it better to do a business that makes and sells very expensive product, which costs somewhat quite a lot of money, and only some people who are quite rich buy, or is it better to do business which makes and sells products which are not that expensive, and a lot of middle-class family or normal people buy a lot of these in a year? A typical question of premium or mass.
Okay. If you ask me, honestly speaking, the pandemic has the answer for you. What happened in the pandemic? What did you buy? Did you go out to buy an iPhone for yourself? Or did you run to the grocery shop to pick up the 1 pound of bread that you need to eat every day? I'm not saying that it would be, that is not the right choice, as in a premium product is not the right choice, but all depends upon how deep your pockets are, what is the problem that you're trying to solve, how important is that product. It's not also just premium and mass, it is also how important that product is in the life of a human being. Is it something that you cannot do without? Then you're in the game. Because if it is something that one can't do without, then it's required, whether it be expensive or whether it be cost-effective, that's not the point. It's an important piece in one's life. If it cannot be, set aside, you're in business. So choose, pragmatically, choose also how many times does the customer, we also look at that at times, is how many times in a lifetime of a customer will the customer buy it? For example, today, a refrigerator is a must in every other family, right? Every other family has a refrigerator. You might buy a smaller one, you might buy a larger one, but the lifetime of a refrigerator is about 10 to 15 years. So after 15 years, you would want to buy another one. That means that people shouldn't make manufactured refrigerators. No, of course they will. So it's an important piece in the, that's the chronology. You can understand that very clearly now. With this example, a refrigerator is a part of our lives now. Food will go bad if we don't have a refrigerator at home. So even if it's an expensive piece and people buy it lesser number of times in their lifetime, yet it's an important piece of our lives. And that's the reason why there are more companies also now manufacturing refrigerators and coming up with better quality ones. Now, within refrigerator ranges, they will have a premium and they will have a mass market product. You need to decide what is your mix going to be. Are you going to do only the mass market product, or are you going to do a mix of both? Can both be your customers? That's what you need to see.
Wonderful. I'll just take the last one, which says, what are the most frequent mistakes to avoid while making a business plan?
What are the most frequent mistakes to avoid?
Mistakes to avoid, yes.
Okay. So a business plan primarily is made on something called assumptions. Your assumptions are what make or what your business plan is based on. So if you are if your assumptions go wrong, then your business plan will not be as perfect. So you need to, the first and primary most thing that you need to do is you need to ensure that your assumptions are right. And to you know, get your assumptions right, you need to talk to as many number of people as possible. Because at every level, when you start asking questions, you get the right answers. I would suggest never start with answers, start with questions. If you look at my entire session today, I had only questions. So if you're asking the right questions, you will definitely hit the right answers. And if you hit the right answers, your business plan is a sure shot success. So this is the first thing. Never start with the answers. Never say, I'm going to do this. Ask yourself a question. And those questions will lead you to the answers, and those will be the correct ones. Because once you ask a question, there will always be another question standing right behind that you need to answer. But the moment you start off with the answers, you've already written in say, letters of gold. There is no, you're not leaving any space for any doubt or for any clarification. So ask yourself a question. So your assumptions will come out right. If you've got your assumptions right, you will be able to, most probably, you will be able to set the right flow for your business plan. Okay. The other mistakes that people make are they don't verify details. If I'm saying that X is going to cost me X or Y, whatever. Suppose I'm saying that I'm doing a costing, my transportation is going to cost me, say, 4 rupees. Have I clarified that? Have I gone and validated it with someone who can tell me, yes, what are the ongoing rates in the market? Have I checked that? If I don't do that, so now that is where the validations will also play a very important part. Because without validations, you will never ever get the matrix right. So one is have the right assumptions. Secondly, validate your assumptions. That's the second mistake that most people make, is not take validations. Thirdly, take a larger subset of validations. Don't go by with just one. I have given a call to someone, one person, and I have taken just one response. I should take at least 5 responses before I go ahead and actually decide on what is the right one. So assumptions, validations. And the next part that will come out of these validations is a structure. So that structure needs to be organized well. You need to see if you're missing out on things or not. Have you missed out on anything? And those are the gaps that one will generally overlook. Now, one important thing about a business plan is it's generally not done in a day. You never sit down and make it at one go. You should not do that. Because the more you mull over it, the more you sleep over it, the more ideas will come to you. Okay? And I think one important part is to question your own self. If I'm doing this, have I covered everything? Is there anything that is left behind? Let's see where I can. So what is the product cycle? What is the journey? Let us follow that journey of others as well first. Take up an example. Work with examples. Of a similar product. So, okay, how does this get manufactured? Where does it get manufactured right now? Okay, how does it come to me? Or how does it come to the customer? What processes does it go through? Can I also go out and have a look at those processes? That's another part. You can actually physically go and visit a factory and say, okay, can I see your process if you don't mind? And most people, should not mind. Or if you have connects, you could go through people. But if you look at those processes, go to the ground, go to the market, meet people, look at those processes, I think those will really help you to come up with a robust business plan. These are the major ones.
Well, Gaurav, thank you so much. This has been a most enriching session. I'm sure the students are as thrilled as I am. So ladies and gentlemen, this was our second masterclass today, Elements of a Business Plan. Thank you so much for being a part of this. Tomorrow at 3 p.m., we'll meet again with our third masterclass, as Gaurav said, where you actually learn the part that is most crucial from the Notebook Ignite standpoint, which is how to make a good pitch. Before leaving, just a couple of things about Notebook. We at Notebook are an EdTech app. We make short videos pertaining to your school curriculum, which makes your life easier and your teachers' teaching process more enjoyable. These videos are specifically designed so that you feel more engaged with the topics that you're going to learn. A short video about Notebook is what I'll leave you with.
Hi there. Are you facing problems with your child's studies? Managing online classes when you have to work from home? Notebook is here to help. Notebook is India's fastest growing online learning platform. Over 2 million students learn using Notebook. Let's see why. Every chapter of every subject is made into short videos that your child can watch on any smartphone or laptop. These videos are made by India's best teachers and just as per the syllabus. This means that these videos are the quickest way to be ready for exams. Every chapter starts with a short interest builder that makes your child want to learn. Studies will never be something that your child gets bored of. Not just videos, there are study notes also. These offer explanation that you won't find in the textbooks. There are also thousands of solved questions, making exams easier to answer. Notebook is India's only learning platform that teaches every subject: maths, science, English, along with history, geography, economics, Hindi, EVS, and many more. Every topic is made into short, interesting videos that makes learning fun and easy. More than 10,000 videos just to help your child learn better. Notebook has been awarded as the best educational app and best educational website. This happened just because we understand what your child needs. So what are you waiting for? Download the Notebook app or visit www.notebook.school and ensure that your child gets the best. Happy learning!
Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for being part of this. We look forward to meeting you again tomorrow. Until then, take care and goodbye.
Thank you.